Hey again and welcome back to the shop. Today's video I'm going to be covering breaking down sheet goods. And so first what I'll cover is a little bit more about the design, and since the time of my last video I've done a full-scale drawing. So that what that information gives me is it kind of just validates or tells me how long each half of the shelf or the serpentine edges will need to be. I kind of worked out what the thicknesses of those edges are going to be when viewed from the front, and thus how thick or tall my bending form components need to be. Just some details like that. So I'll go ahead and give you guys a first person shot of how I do a sheet goods breakdown. It's pretty basic, pretty rough, but it accomplishes the goal I need to accomplish. As you can see here beside me, I took the time a couple hours yesterday just breaking down the sheet goods into the major components that are going to make each part of the bending form up. So before I break down any sheet goods when I'm building a form or a jig or anything that I do out of sheet goods, really, I find it pretty invaluable to do a cut sheet of some sort. And in my experience, I don't find it necessary to do this on a SketchUp or a computer or anything like that. It's pretty basic to just draw it out on paper. So I'm gonna go through, may not be able to see this as well as I can, but I'm gonna go through how I do that. So first of all, what I do after I did my full scale drawing is I'll make a list of what the components are that make up the jig, what the rough size of them will be. Obviously these the discs that will make up the bending form are going to be circles, so each one being an 11 inch diameter. So knowing that information after I do a full scale drawing and I like the way it looks and I've got all the proportions worked out to my satisfaction, I'll make a list of every part that I need. The quantity total, I'm going to be building two flat platform bending forms. So I just make a list. So discs, they're 11 inch diameter. I'm gonna need 24 discs, and that 24 discs will cover, obviously there's gonna be 1, 2, 3, 4 of these circles. Each circle, as I mentioned in the previous video, will be made of 3 3/4 inch thick pieces, giving me a total, if we were to look at it in profile view, of about 2 1/4 inches. So in my full scale drawing, each half of this, or each component that I'm going to be bending, will be 2 inches wide. And so that 2 1/4 inch height is what I need, at least 2 inches, obviously, to provide full support as I bend this around. So having that information just tells me that I'm going to need a total of 24 discs. As far as calls go, calls being the components that I'm going to use during the bending process to apply even clamping force to these outside curves. Again, made up of 3 3/4 inch thick pieces of plywood to give me enough height to provide the support I need. So knowing that information and kind of prioritizing, lastly, before I skip around, there's the backer. So the backer will be the platform, if you will, that I'll be screwing these circular forms too. And those will be wide enough. I've set that aside to be 18 inches wide, 17 to 18 inches. That's gonna give me enough width, not only to adequately cover the 11 inch wide discs, but also give me a place that I'll be able to set the calls on the form next to the pieces as I work through the bend. As I mentioned before, once I have the pieces hot and steamed, I've got about a minute to accomplish setting this up and clamping this all down. So that extra width is just gonna give me a little bit more room and make it a little bit easier for me to just slap the call on the side of the platform next to the disc. As I bend that around, I'll be able to just slide it up against there, throw a clamp on, and that'll make that process a little bit easier. If I just tried to make the platform 11 inches wide, it's gonna be a little bit more tricky to throw that call next to it and get the proper alignment and not end up twisting the call. Just save me that much, you know, it'll be seconds that I'll save, but it's worth it in the end. So we've got the discs, the calls, the backer. This is not to scale. There's nothing about this that's particularly exciting, but I draw out a rectangle that represents a 48 inch by 96 inch piece of plywood. And then I just go through and by quantity, typically, it doesn't really matter, but I know each disc will be 11 inch in diameter. So 11 and a half, 11 and a half, 11 and a half. So 3 times 8 gives me the 24 discs that I need. So you can see right here, what I've got roughed out are 11 and a half inch wide ripped strips of plywood. And then I'll cross cut those 7 times to get my 8 pieces that I need. And I'll go through the pattern routing in this layout here in a second. So for this particular piece, you know, I've got about 13 inches left on the edge of this sheet once I've ripped those discs out, which you just saw. So what's left essentially and what I've decided to do, I could have either made a more narrow backer out of that 13 inches, but again, that doesn't give me the width that I need to confidently place and clamp down my calls. So I decided for that last 13 inch strip, what I do is make my calls out of that. So my calls are going to be 4.5 inches wide. So this is a representation. This one's actually 4 inches the way I drew it out, but the width really determines how much coverage along the radius of the circle that I'm going to be able to apply clamping pressure. If this were a 2-inch call, leaving enough thickness to give this adequate strength where the clamp will be actually applying force, I've left 1.5 inches here at the thinnest part, and so this still gives me 2.5 inches from the top of that arc where I'll be able to apply even clamping force. Again, the only difference between the pattern that I've made here and the pattern here, and you don't see it because I didn't draw it in, but I need to allow for the 3/8 inch thick piece of wood that'll actually be sandwiched between here. So instead of a 5.5 inch radius that makes up the disc form, this will be a radius of 3/8 inch larger. So when I put this, sandwich the steam bent piece of wood in between it, I should have a nice even amount of pressure all the way around there. And that's these components here. I've got 6 4.5 inch plus or minus 4.5 inch wide strips of plywood that I've cut out of my sheet goods. Now, I mentioned it would take me 2 sheets. So what I've got here is this is the representation of the second sheet. I've gone with plus or minus 17 inch wide strips for my backer. Each one will be about 48 inches long, which is plenty long for me to mount all the discs. The next strip or width that I cut off is again 3 more 4 inch plus or minus 4 inch wide strips that'll make up the calls. And then this piece will be used obviously for the future, call it the reference disc or the routing disc that I'll use to cut the half laps. So I'll save this one for later once I've got everything built and I can do some measurements and actually probably take a couple of test pieces and run them through and then determine exactly where these two pieces are going to cross. I'm going to have to find the exact center line of that before I determine the diameter of the disc that I'll use as a pattern to cut those half laps. So at this point, that kind of covers how I think about ripping down my sheet goods. So pattern routing, a lot of you guys are probably very familiar with this concept, but it's really just a very simple way to make repetitive shapes using what you might call a master. So this is my master. I took the time to find the center point or approximately the center point. It's not that important as long as I've got a gap all the way around. So when I cut these out roughly on the bandsaw, I drew this one out because the master is going to be the disc that I make all the other discs from. And what I'll do is I'll cut this out, like I mentioned, on the bandsaw. And on my disc sander, I will very, very carefully come up to just kissing the pencil line and then refine that likely with sandpaper or whatever I feel will work the best, depending on how this plywood behaves and how much chip out I get. So once I've got this disc Absolutely perfect. What I'll do with the other blanks is I'll draw a circle out on those the same way I did this, but I won't bother with getting those perfect. I'll cut them out on the bandsaw, leaving probably an eighth inch all the way around. I'll screw one disc to the master, and using one of these three bits, I'm not sure, this is my preferred bit. If this gives me enough height, we can look at it here. I'll put the master on the bottom, and hopefully I'll be able to route two discs that I can screw in on top of that and cut my routing time in half. I would definitely not recommend using a bit this heavy in a light duty or any kind of router that's really not a high quality router. You're going to get some pretty poor results. These are just other examples of the same thing. So depending on how this goes, I'll just choose whichever bit is going to save me the most time and give me the best results. And that's pretty much it. So when I come back, I'll have all these components ripped down to length. All right, so now you can see that I've got all the previously ripped sheet goods cut down to rough width. Here are going to be, I guess this is 23, about 11.5 by 11.5 blanks for the discs. And here in the foreground, this is going to be the material for the culls, and those are sitting on top of what will eventually be the backer pieces. Before I go on to cutting, I tend to work in methods of what's going to take me the longest to accomplish, and really between doing all the pattern routing that I've got ahead of me, first thing obviously I need to do is transfer the master circle. I mentioned before that I was going to use the compass and draw this out, and that's just dumb. I'm really going to use the master and set it on top of each one of my blanks and trace it out before roughing it out on the bandsaw. I want to share a couple tips before I move on. Number one, and I'm also going to show you the template here in a little bit better detail. Maybe. So you should be able to see, and maybe not, but what I've done is rough sawn this initial master out on the bandsaw, and using my disc sander, sanded just right to the line all the way around. And really the best tool that you can possibly use to check the fairness of this curve is your fingertip. And what you can do is just rip your finger around there and feel for any divots or abnormalities. And this one turned out pretty darn good. There's a couple of very, very minor imperfections, but I'm not too worried about it. And really what I want to share is I'm not super big on buying the best quality material for jig making, but there are a couple of advantages to spending a little bit more money on the plywood that you use. Now this plywood, you can see it, it's a 6-ply material. What I love about this particular sheet good, and I got it at one of the local big box stores, but there is no, it's not Baltic birch clearly. It's a 6-ply softwood plywood, and I prefer to stay away from the Baltic birch, the veneered type plywoods for jig making, because as you cut on the bandsaw, or you're ripping on the table saw, or you're going to be pattern routing all these edges, I've just in the past experienced a lot of chipping, and what that'll do, it just creates imperfections, gaps, little minute problems that can come back to haunt you down the road and flake off. And you know, over time, and as I use these jigs and I'm applying these steam bent pieces up against the edges, I found that when I've used the veneered plywood in the past, it just tends to flake off over time and it's annoying. So I prefer to stay away from the veneered stuff. The second thing about spending a little bit more money on a decent grade form material is it simply holds screws better. I use another tip. These are SPACs. Essentially, they're self-tapping. They don't split the wood. You can find articles about these screws in all kinds of magazines, but they
really do what they say they're going to do. This is about $8 per pound for these screws, regardless of what size you buy. And the reason I prefer them, and I've used drywall screws in the past and they're fine, but drywall screws tend to snap if you're using a high quality plywood or especially a hardwood. And therefore that necessitates the additional work of pre-drilling and countersinking all your holes when you're screwing these pieces together. You can install the spec screws with absolutely no breakage, no pre-drilling, no splitting, regardless of how close you get to the edge. So the biggest advantage of these is simply the time savings of having to pre-drill, and they countersink themselves, so I won't have to waste the time countersinking those. So that's about it. I'm going to get started with transferring this circle to all my blanks, and we'll go ahead and start cutting those out on the bandsaw. Now that I've got my bending discs roughed out on the bandsaw, I'm going to turn my attention to laying out and roughing out all of the cauls. Now, similar to the bending discs, I'm going to create a master. And now I'm going to show you a way when, obviously, my caul blanks are not wide enough to, you know, easily and accurately lay out the radius that's going to be cut into this. So from a wide angle here, what I've done is I've just set two pieces of plywood next to what will eventually be the two backers, and putting those in the same plane, giving me a distance from where I'm going to be drawing this arc on this plane, gives me a more accurate way to lay out the radius. So I'll zoom in on this and how I draw that onto the blanks. Now first let's take a look at the sketch that I've done. Now, I originally planned that my cauls would be 4 inches thick, and that would give me adequate clamping pressure around the outside arc of each bending disc. And when I cut these caul blanks, I actually cut them a little bit wider because I had a little bit extra plywood to work with, so I want those as thick as possible. And the way I determine the layout on this is, first of all, I need a couple pieces of information. One is, how much material do I want to leave behind the workpiece that I'm going to be clamping against to provide adequate strength? When I go to clamp this, I don't want the caul to bend or deform in any way. I want it to bend the workpiece. So what I just kind of threw out a number, and what I ended up with on my blank, since I am at about 4 1/4 inches wide, roughly, I'm going with 1 5/8 from the back edge to where the inside face of the caul will be after I cut it and route it. And given that these will be stacked 3 high and screwed together, that ought to be more than strong to bend a 3/8 inch thick workpiece. Now there's a couple of things that are very important when you're going to do a call like this or any kind of male female form work. That is obviously the accuracy or parallelism of the call and the, we'll call it the female and the male components. Now, given that I'm going to be pattern rounding this and I took a lot of time and effort in shaping my master for the bending disc, I'm going to take the same level of care and effort in shaping the master for the female or the call. Now, the easy way to kind of figure all this out, and like I mentioned, I've got these in the same plane. I've drawn a line at random, just perpendicular to this edge so it's square. I drew a line down this workpiece. That gives me a reference line to set the end of my compass at when I draw this arc, which I've already done, obviously. So in this case, what we've got is a 5.5-inch inside radius, a 3/8-inch workpiece, and then X amount of distance to the outside edge of the call. What I'm most concerned about is finding that radius, which will be 5.5 plus 3/8 will give me 5 7/8. So knowing where I put this random mark, we'll call it, I know it's 1 5/8, but I don't know what this distance is. So very carefully I measured the distance from the edge of my blank to where I put this mark, and that was 2 17/32 from there to there. Now I know my overall radius needs to be 5 7/8, or stated another way, 5 28/32. What I need to do is take my 5 28/32 minus what I've already got here and draw that down this line, and that's where I'll set the end of my compass. So 5 28/32 overall, I subtract my 2 17/32, and that gives me 3 11/32. So from this edge of my random piece, I drew a point down 3 11/32, butt these up against each other, and I measured it just because, but I've got 5 7/8 from the center point of my arc to that point right there. So after I've got that information, I set my compass not against the marks that I made, but I set it against my actual stair rule, and then I check it just by putting it up against my marks, and it was dead on, and I drew the arc. So that's a pretty sound way to draw an arc on a piece that's really not large enough for you to just measure, draw a straight line across the entire thing and draw your line out. So I went ahead and rough cut about 1/8 of an inch, 1/16 of an inch away from my arc line for the master call. And I wanted to quickly show you my version of a spindle sander. This is a Porter Cable, I believe it's a model 121 oscillating spindle sander. I love this tool. I bought it on Craigslist for like $50. And obviously it's well used. It's covered in all kinds of paint, and some other carpenter probably got a lifetime of use out of it. And I've had it for about 6 years, and I love it because I can take it to the work, or I can put it in my vise here and use it as a mini spindle sander. It does come with different diameter spindles, and it oscillates not an incredible amount, but like 3/4 of an inch. So it does what I need it to do. And you know, if you're on a budget, this is a terrific little tool. It's got a pretty powerful motor. I've never really bogged it down with any work that I've done. If you wanted to, you could build a little box for it and increase the size of the platform. And that would be an option too. So I'm going to spare you the boredom of me sanding this out and shaping it out. But my goal here is to get real close to the line, feel this out with my fingers. I want to basically try to split my pencil line in half if I can. And that's going to give me the optimal parallelism that I'm looking for between the male and the female parts of the call. Alright, so I've got the master completely flush and smooth, and pretty proud of this. It's so close that I wouldn't even be able to show you But there's just a fraction of the pencil line remaining all the way along this arch, and it's just absolutely fair and smooth. So the only thing I wanted to point out, I'm not going to videotape me marking these out, but in order to mark these quickly and easily, I'm using my miter gauge fence just to give me, instead of like trying to use a flat surface and hold them and mark them out, I just use my miter gauge fence and butt up what will be the clamping face after these are all cut. I'll just butt that up against there, hold the edges so that they're parallel. Each of these have been cut to the same length. So I'll just flush the edges with my fingers, make sure I'm up against the fence, and mark out the arches. So this morning I've gone ahead and I transferred the master pattern to all of the call blanks and roughed them out on the bandsaw. So now I'm ready to start assembling and pattern routing the calls. And I wanted to start with the calls first. I want, when I'm done screwing these together, I want a flat back. So this will be the back that I'm going to be clamping against. And obviously this will be the side that's against the workpiece. So what I've done here is I've just a little setup. This is my router fence, and I've got a little stop block that I've set against one edge. So as I assemble these, I've got a reference face on the back and one corner. So that's all I need to do in order to screw these up. Now what I'm also going to be doing, kind of a sequence of operations, I'm going to have a total, if we look at our drawing here, I need for each half of the bending form, a left side and a right side, I'm going to need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and potentially a sixth bottom call if this is going to be a wall hanging unit. I didn't explain it earlier, but if I were doing a floor standing unit, I'm not going to need a bottom call because the bottom half or three-quarter segment of the circle will end up being the legs, and I'll add a thickened laminated piece to that just to give it proportion and more stability. If I'm doing a wall hung unit, the bottom will actually be a full round just like the top will be. So I need that sixth call, a total of 12 calls. So knowing that, what I want to do to create each call assembly is I'm going to do a total of 12, I'll call them clones from the master. So I'll end up taking, screwing these two together, these are just roughs on, putting my master on it, screwing that to it, and I'll use the same two screw holes every time I do it so I don't tear up the master. And then once I pattern route that, I'll take it apart and I'll have two clones, and I'll repeat that 6 times. And then what I'll do with the clones and the original master is screw them to the rest of the blanks. So I'll end up with 12 sets of blanks. Each will have a clone or a master screwed to the top of it. And once I'm at that point, and I've got an assembly where each one has one reference face that I can route from. As I showed you earlier, I've set out my router with the pattern jig, and I'll take each one, flip it over, so it's sitting on the bench with the master or the clone down on the face, and I just use this, I don't know, it's like a shelving liner. It, you know, you can buy router pads or whatever, this works just as well. I prefer to take the router to the work, and the reason I don't use my router table that often is it's just not safe without having to build another platform or another way to hold these edges secure as I do it. I find that if I've got this on a non-skid surface and I've got one edge referenced against some kind of stop and when I'm doing it freehand, I've never really had any problems so long as I take my time and just do small passes. I get the other reason I'm starting with the calls is I'm not real sure how well this plywood material is gonna behave, so I wanna see, this is a variable speed router, so I'll be adjusting the speeds as I go through each one of these, creating these clones, to try to figure out what speed's kinda optimal for getting the best cuts on this material with the Notera. Okay, so now I've got all 12, as I mentioned, the clones, or 12 masters, one for each of the final calls. Taking the liberty off camera, I went ahead and screwed together the rough sawn blanks. So now all I need to do is mount each of the masters to the blanks against my reference face. Go ahead and screw those together, flip them upside down, and pattern route both of the blanks with the each master at the same time. One thing that, and this has happened to me almost every time that I repetitively bearing route against almost any surface except for like a hardwood, what it's done, you can only feel it, you can't even really see it, but after about the sixth, third or fourth time that I used this, the bearing actually started to compress the wood a little bit, and I noticed that as I felt it, even though it didn't feel flush, they really were coming off the pattern flush. So what I ended up doing is just taking one of the duplicates that I already done on the first pass along this surface and set this one aside and started routing using another one of the masters. So just something to be aware of. And so now that I've got everything kind of pre-screwed and everything screwed together, all I need to do is go ahead and finish these off. Make sure I'm up against my reference, which will be the back. And I'm gonna go ahead and screw these in. With each of the masters screwed to the rough blanks, again, I'll route them upside down on the setup that you saw in the still earlier. And when I come back, we'll start talking about the discs and my procedure for those. So now I've got all 12 of the clamping calls finished routed, and those are done. I don't need to do anything else with those at this point. So I'm going to turn my attention to pattern routing the bending discs. And what I've done here, I'll just explain it real quickly. First of all, these two lines represented the rough center line when the disc was still a square. That's really no longer the center line, but just for the sake of kind of figuring out where my holes would be for placement of the clamps and where I'd end up placing the screws, I went ahead and just laid out off that center line. But I'll show you guys later, after I've got 8 masters created. Now, based on what I learned from routing the calls, what I'm going to do is just route. I'm going to screw this to one piece, one other disc, and route that, unscrew it, screw it to the next disc until I have 8 masters. Since I'm going to be using these screw holes over and over, this will be, I've got gone an inch and an eighth in from the outer edges, about 45 from where the clamping holes will be. That's going to be the actual location of the final screws. I want them to be somewhat close to the edge so that those edges are nice and tight when I screw them together and do the pattern routing. For these, I've also gone about an inch plus or minus to the outside edge of this 2-inch diameter hole. So once I have all 8 masters done, I can't mount them to the backing form until I've got these 2-inch holes drilled. So I'll, similar to the calls, I'll create the 8 masters. I'll mount the 8 masters to 2 discs at a time at that point. So one master will be sitting on top of this, I'll screw these together and then screw the master on top, flip it upside down, route it, and then when I come back, I'll show you how to find the center line, and then from the new center line, I'll lay out lines and locate the holes that I'll actually be drilling. Again, this was more for illustrative purposes and to help me visually figure out where everything was going to be. And again, for the cutting pattern that I'll use, this should give me plenty of real estate in between these screws and these holes to figure out how to mount that concentric to this circle. It will be a larger diameter. Okay, I wanted to show right quick the purpose of all these lines, and etc. So I've got my blank here. I know where my screws are located on the bottom, so all I need to do is transfer those lines, the crosshairs that I drew where the screws are, just so I know later on I can reference these little tick marks to make sure that I avoid the location for the screws. So, not being super accurate, but I just want to make some reference marks. So there's my reference marks. Now I know where they're at here. So when I draw my crosshairs, I want to, I'll be in between those lines, find the exact center of a circle, place the vertex of a square against the outer circumference, mark the outside square edges of your triangle or whatever you're using. Okay, so I've got those marks. And what I'll do is line up my square. This center line is important because I may end up referencing it in the future, depending on how I cut the joinery for the intersecting shelves. So this is not going to be the crosshairs that I'm going to use to drill the clamping holes. It's just a reference center line. So I'm not going to draw these lines all the way across the disc. Okay, so there's my exact center point. Now what I'm going to do to make sure that my crosshairs and where I drill the clamp holes is as far away from my screw lines as possible is I'm just going to look back at the edge. My fingers are where those marks are. I just want to kind of line them up so they're about the same distance from the edge of my bench as a visual reference. Put my square on here, so I'm about halfway between those marks. I don't fuss too much about this part of it. And I'll draw my crosshairs all the way out to the edge. Now this is the bottom disc on one, so I'm going to have a hole on each side and a hole at the bottom. You'll notice I didn't draw my line all the way through the center line because I don't want to distort that point. So coming off 90 on that, line up my square to the reference line. Come on the other side. So then, I've got my square set to 2 1/8. I'm going to be drilling a 2-inch diameter hole, so I'll end up having an 1 1/8 from the edge. And this doesn't have to be exactly perfect here, because when I drill it, I'm not going to fuss around too much about getting these exact. And then I just circle where I'm going to drill and label this disc with a B for bottom. So that's it. All right, here we are at the drill press. I've got my 2-inch bit chucked in the press and I've set my depth. I've got a backer board here so I can drill all the way through the piece and get a nice clean exit hole. That's pretty important. What I'm gonna do before I drill this is I'm gonna draw this line out on my backer so that every time I come in and reference this, I roughly will hit the same exit hole each time. Safety wise, whenever you're using a bit this big on a piece this small, it's pretty important to go ahead and clamp this down each time and drill the hole. I just don't feel comfortable with that much bit and just trying to secure this by hand. It could easily spin out on me and cause some problems. So it's definitely a good idea to do that. And I'm not gonna tape the actual drilling, but I will show you how I'm gonna clamp it. As I mentioned, these clamp holes are not really all that important. Gotta mark my circle. And to reference those bottom holes, you can see that I've went ahead and drawn my crosshair for the clamp holes down. So I'm going to have a reference line the same as this on each one. So I'll just come in and register that same place. So no matter where I turn this, I've got roughly the same exit hole coming out. And I'm not going to, offset that exit hole and end up chipping out the bottom and having to deal with that, sand it out, or whatever the case may be. So with that information down, I just slide the whole assembly, check my location, and that's good. And it's just about the right size. I can just come in here and clamp that down. Clamp that down and go ahead and start drilling. So the bending forms are complete. You saw in the previous stills how I was securing these during the screwing. That was just to make sure that all my reference lines, which the center line that I drew across the face of the jig using a drywall square, I just needed a straight line in order to align all the center lines. Obviously these crosshairs for the clamping holes were really not that critical, but these lines may come in handy at a future time. There's all kinds of possibilities that for different designs that I can use this same set of forms with. This coating is just a polyurethane that I threw on there to kind of help preserve my lines as best as possible. One thing I might not have shown in the stills was I drew a couple reference lines on the back just to assist me in expediting the screwing in of the discs. So that's pretty much it. Couple things I wanted to point out. You saw in the stills how I was using a spacer block to make sure that between the two forms the spacing between all the discs is exactly the same. I based the spacing on essentially a guess, but you can kind of see here, these were scraps from the test bends, how that the intersection between the two mirrored halves will roughly be spaced. And I think that's going to give me
adequate glue surface in this half lap joint. I talked in previous segments about essentially the importance of the center line, and that was because my thought was I was going to have another disc with a slightly larger diameter that I was going to use as a pattern to cut the half laps with a router. And after a lot more thought, I've decided against going that method, and I'm going to be cutting all these half laps by hand. I just don't think that factors including the consistency of the bend, if you think about how I'd have to do that pattern routing, I'd have to come across one surface, transverse that, and come down the other way in order for these half laps to work. That would be pretty difficult with all the variables of steam bending and the exact spacing of the discs and a bunch more factors that I'm just worried about the accuracy, and ultimately I want these joints to be pretty much perfect. So after I bend the two halves and I place them on top of each other, as kind of this representation shows, I'm gonna knife line these and cut them all and do it all by hand. So I guess I'm a glutton for punishment, but that's kind of the results that I'm expecting, is pretty much perfection. Last thing I want to point out, with this, two exact bending forms, it gives me a lot of possibility in design, in that I could do a small, call it a countertop mounted shelf with one disc. I could do a two shelf unit using two discs, and that could be freestanding or floor standing. And in case you couldn't visualize what the floor standing one will look like, obviously I showed in a previous little section up here at the top where the two mirrored halves come together, I'll do a half lap, which is where this reference line will come in handy to mark out the shoulders for those joints. And at the bottom, let's say I've got my two mirrored halves and I'm bending one coming around, what I'll do is create a spacer block that's wide enough. I haven't really figured out what the dimension will be, but I'll create a block that will reference the bottom, and what I'll be able to do is as the bend comes around, I can clamp it to that block, which will be offset from this outer circumference, and essentially that will become a leg where I can laminate a thicker piece onto it, some kind of a neat element here where it gives it a heavier, thicker appearance at the bottom, and obviously wider for stability purposes. So I could create a three shelf unit, a four shelf unit, whatever a client may want, I can create with the same set of forms. And then just also so you can visualize, again, obviously these calls are 3/8 inch diameter larger, which obviously is very intentional. I'm gonna be machining the white oak that I'm going to use, at least initially, at exactly 3/8 of an inch thick. So when I use these calls, if I could space this exactly 3/8, it'd be equidistant all the way around the circumference. So that should assist me in just getting nice consistent bends. Aesthetically, it should be very pleasing. So I appreciate you watching, and we'll check you later.